I graded the portfolios yesterday. So there's a couple straggler things I haven't graded. Some old assignments that people are turning in or turning in corrections to. But other than that, I did grade the portfolios. My comments on the portfolios, for the most part, in fact, can't really think of any or many exceptions. So everyone did a really good job on them. So keep up the good work. The one thing I would say is there's a couple people that did not get full credit. Wasn't that their portfolio was bad so much as they had an issue creating the links and the links to files. Remember, you should never see anything in the source of an image or the href that looks like this. So you should never have an image that looks like this. /cis216/image.jpg. What's wrong with doing that?
It's searching out the path on your...
Yeah, it's going to look on my machine. If I don't happen to have a thumb drive plugged in that says E, that's named E and has a folder called John Doe CISS216, then it's not going to show the image. So a couple people did that, and you know, just correct it and resubmit it, and you'll get full credit. Same thing for links, by the way. So if you had href equals and had the same sort of path, that would cause the same issue. The solution, of course, would be if it's in the same folder, you just need the file name. So something like this would work if it's in the same folder. If it's not in the same folder, if it's in a folder underneath where your page is, so if your page is here, and then you have a subfolder called images that has image.jpg in it, then you would say images/image.html. You wouldn't do the full path of E:\, or C:\, and so on. You'd do that. That's if the image is in a folder underneath where the web page is. What else? Oh, I mentioned for a few people that they should have a link back to the portfolio page. And I did deduct for that because I think in class I might have said something like, I don't really need a link back to it. But as I was grading it, it really makes more sense. You know, you should have the link. So I didn't take off for it. But going forward, when you turn it in again, have a link. Now, the question you might ask is some people had a separate folder for each of their labs and then had a portfolio page and a folder above it. So a lot of people did something like this. They had a folder for their portfolio, and they had their portfolio page. And underneath that, they had a lab 1 folder, a lab 2 folder, and so on. So underneath lab 1, there might be a lab 1.html, and so on down the line. A lot of people did that, and it's probably the easiest way to do it. I didn't really talk about doing that in class. I don't remember talking about it in class. But a lot of people picked up on that and did it that way, which is great. All right. Now, the question is how do you make a link between those two pages? Well, between this page and this page, you follow what I just said. This page is in a folder underneath where this page lives, so you would put the folder name. So if I wanted a link from portfolio to lab 1, I would say a href equals always a forward slash. It's never a backslash. I know some of you that have done work with Windows recognize that Windows uses the backslash for, as a directory separator. It doesn't matter. This is actually, it doesn't depend on the operating system. Within URLs, you always use the forward slash. You probably should match the case of it too. In other words, if it's a capital L in lab one, it should be a capital L in lab one. All right. Again, that won't necessarily get you into trouble all the time, but under some circumstances it could. I've seen issues with that. Now the question is how do you make the link back up from lab one back up to the portfolio? That's something we haven't covered yet, although a lot of people figured it out. You would do this. Ahref equals dot dot slash portfolio. If any of you did CISS 125 and you do command line stuff in it and you move around with directories, this is the same sort of thing. And the reason for this is quite simple, that every folder can have a bunch of folders underneath it, but every folder is only in one folder. So this portfolio folder can have a lab 1 and a lab 2 and a lab 3 and a lab 4 folder underneath it. So if you want to go down to a folder, you have to specify the name of the folder. So I have to say, I want the page called lab1.html that's in the lab 1 folder. And that's what that says. To go up, if you're in this folder and you want to go up the folder, you simply just say dot dot, and that means up a directory. So in your, if you're going to draw a tree structure, which are these are called, or portfolio is that directory, then underneath it you have a lab 1, lab 2, lab 3, lab 4. As you go down the tree, it branches off in potentially many directions. Whereas if you go up, you only go up to one parent. So you do the dot dot slash for that. Other than that, good job. This class is a lot more fun grading than many of my other classes, to be honest. Because, you know, it's very visual. I get to see the work. And a lot of people have done really a good job, creative job, putting their portfolio together. I would urge you in lab to take a minute and ask your neighbor to see what they're working on and maybe what they did on the portfolio or what they're doing on their project as that comes near to completion. Not in terms of copying it, obviously, but in terms of getting inspiration and seeing what they can do. And if they do something cool that you don't know how to do, ask them. All right? Back in the old days when we programmed on a mainframe, all right, we had labs in here because, like, no one had a computer at home, right? So you had to go to lab to work on the computer, all right? Well, that's a little different now. I know a lot of people prefer to work on their own computer at home, so they don't stay for lab. And I'm fine with that, whatever works for you. But one advantage of going to lab is you have a chance to collaborate with people and see what other people are doing and get some advice from them and so on. So, you know, that's a reason to go to lab. What would you do to the portfolio when you're done with it? All right. Well, obviously you're going to turn it in for the grade, but this definitely can be put on a website for potential employers. You know. Now, maybe you wouldn't literally want every one of your assignments on it, right? Because you know, the first few assignments aren't earth-shattering. But you could pick a handful of the work that you're the most proud of and actually put it up on the web. That's a great thing about web development as opposed to other careers. All right? If I was going to be a nuclear engineer, all right, I can't simply build a power plant in my backyard and practice my nuclear engineering in the backyard without causing myself and my neighbors and probably Homeland Security a lot of issues, right? Because again, you just can't do that. People don't have access to that, all right? And you can think of a lot of careers that are like that. You know, you can't practice them in a way until you have the job. You can study about them in school, but until you get a job, there's really no place for you to do it on your own. Web development isn't like that. You can absolutely do web development on your own and showcase your work. You know, when you go for a job, people, first and foremost, they want to know if you can do the job, right? That's what they're interested in. Now, there's a bunch of ways you can demonstrate that you can do the job, all right? You can show what grades you got in school. You can show, you know, what previous jobs that you've had and so on. But especially for people breaking into a field, they may have some job experience that may be relevant to a degree. But a good way to show it is with a portfolio and to say, well, look, hey, when I was in class, I developed these websites. And you can put them out on a web server. Later on in the semester, we'll talk about putting them up on a web server and so on. I would imagine that's sort of the last part of the puzzle that we have not talked about. Once you finish with a web page and it works on your machine, how do you get it out to the world? You know, that's the question that we need to answer at some point this semester. If I don't mention it, remind me. So by the end of the semester, I will want to have talked about that. All right. The design for your project is due, I believe, next week. Is that a correct statement? Okay. So by all means, that should be, you know, you sort of have two things going on for the next week. You know, number one, you know, there's no new assignment due, all right? So if you're caught up, that's great. Just focus on the design of your project, all right? I will do my best to give you feedback of your design as quickly as I can, all right? That being said, you should not let, you know, you should continue working on it so that you have a great job at the by the end of the semester. And by all means, ask any questions that you have. Remember, the design consists of a written document that contains four parts, and then it consists of a prototype, which should be sort of a rough draft of your pages. And these are actually done in HTML, CSS, and images. Now, they don't have to be completed web pages. You know, you could be sketchy on some details. But it should give me an idea of what the final project is going to look like. I shouldn't look at it and have no idea what direction you're going as far as the layout and the design of the page. All right. I did not make it a requirement to have a couple different CSS files. But that would actually be something cool to play around with if you wanted to, all right, is to develop your website, develop your prototype, and then have a second CSS file. You could ask me, you could ask your classmates, which one you like better, and use that one going forward in your design. All right. The topic for today is accessibility. I think the assignment that's due this week, you had to create a web page about mobile devices and one about accessibility. Accessibility when you develop websites is about making the website accessible to people regardless of their different abilities and or disabilities. All right? And I mean, the same term comes up when you talk about physical spaces. All right, as well as web spaces. Now, what are some barriers, you know, and when you think about this, there are physical disabilities that provide, that pose a bit of a barrier or pose obstacles for people trying to navigate a physical space or a website. There's assistive technology that's stuff that can be used to help people get around those barriers. And then finally, there are things that can be done to either help or hamper people with those assistive technologies. All right? Let me give you an example. One disability that would be relevant to getting around on campus would be if you were confined to a wheelchair. technology? Well, there's the wheelchair itself. And there are remote controls for doors. All right. That is, I don't know if you've seen people in a wheelchair, like the doors that go between the buildings, they have a little clicker that they click, like a garage door opener almost. And when they press that button, the door opens. All right. So that's assistive technology that helps you get around. Now, design considerations are things that we can either look at these as a positive or a negative. In terms of a positive, it's the things that we want to do to help and make sure that those assistive technologies do what they're supposed to. If we look at it from the opposite, it's the things that we could do that would break the assistive technology. For example, a design consideration is having elevators. If we did have elevators in this building, or on any building on campus, then a person could have the best wheelchair in the world, but it wouldn't do them any good because it would become very difficult for them to get up the stairs. All right? So I guess you could call elevators an assistive technology, but it's not. They're not usually thought of that way because they're there for everyone, right? They're there for everyone regardless of their ability or disability. All right? Another thing would be the automatic doors that I mentioned. Remote control for doors doesn't do any good if the doors aren't automatic to begin with. All right. Another thing would be, you know, proper size of doorways, bathroom stalls, etc. So here's the idea. We have an issue that people encounter that they want to resolve. They have some tools that help them to resolve that. But designers of buildings need to take those things into account when designing the building and to let those things do the job that they're supposed to do. I guess another thing would be ramps. Now here's an interesting observation. And we're talking about physical access now, of just managing your way around campus. All right? Here's an interesting observation. Look at all those design considerations. Do those only benefit people that are confined to wheelchairs?
No.
No. All right? Elevator. When would someone maybe want to use an elevator that isn't confined to a wheelchair? Yeah, they just don't want to use the stairs. Maybe they have arthritis in their knees. All right, maybe they had an injury. All right, maybe they're carrying a ton of books. All right, and going upstairs with a ton of books can be difficult. Maybe they have an audiovisual cart, you know, that they're carting around something on. All right, the point is yes. You need elevators in your building for people with disabilities, but it also serves the needs of people that aren't disabled. All right? Same thing with automatic doors. If my arms are full, if I have lunch in one hand, books in another, it's nice if I can hit a button on the wall and have the automatic doors, and so on. So a lot of these design considerations, again, benefit people that don't have the disability. Or again, people that maybe have, I guess what I'd call a mild form of the disability or a temporary form of the disability. You know, there are people that are confined to a wheelchair permanently because of an injury or a condition or whatever. But there's some people that, you know, they broke their leg. And so they are using a wheelchair or crutches for 6 weeks or whatever. All right. Or someone that didn't break their leg, but they have an injury that makes sometimes difficult to go up the stairs. All right. So my observations are that we can talk about a disability. We recognize that many of the things we do to design for that disability have benefits to other people as well. And we find that any disability we identify, there are sort of other related conditions to it that are relevant when you're talking about designing a building and making it accessible to them. All right? I'm going to check something right now because I think there might be a little bit of accommodations for disabled people right outside our door. All right? Let me check. I've checked a couple times, and sometimes it's there, and sometimes it's not. It's there. Does anyone know what I mean? What accommodation for someone with a disability is right outside our door? Yes.
Is it the Braille?
Yes, there's Braille underneath the door number. All right? Be honest. How many of you realize there's Braille underneath the door number? All right. Few people did, a few people didn't, right? That's another consideration with some of these design considerations, all right? Many of the design considerations that are there, all right, they help people that don't have that disability, but if people don't have that disability, it's not like it's hindering you. It's not like, gee, I can't figure out where room 205 is because there's Braille underneath the 205. Right? Didn't make it harder for you to access this room, whether or not you noticed it or not. So some accommodations for people with disabilities can help people. Many of them, even if they don't help other people, at least they don't hurt, they don't make it difficult. In other words, you don't have to take the elevator coming up here. You know, some people would rather take the stairs and get, you know, they feel rather than waiting for an elevator, they can get up the stairs quicker. So it's not like you're forced to use these. So we're not making the building only for people with disabilities, we're making the building for everyone. This notion is called universal design. All right, let's bring this back to web development now. I brought these examples up, this example up, because even if you don't know anything about web development and accessibility, hopefully you've seen and thought about people in wheelchairs and that have other conditions and how they get around and can identify with some of these examples. We're going to keep the same thing up here. But first, I want to identify all the potential issues that exist for people, all the potential disabilities that exist for people accessing the web. What are some things that could affect someone's ability to access the web? Yes?
They're blind.
The web is so visual. You know, you see the text, you see the pictures, you see the links, there can be videos, all these animations, all these things that are so highly visual. It's a visual medium. So that's the first thing that people think about. And I don't blame them. Alright? Now, a couple things to consider with that though. It's certainly not the only one. And what we're going to do first is we're going to identify the different disabilities that are relevant here. And secondly, I've heard people say something like, well, I use alt attributes on my image, so my website is accessible. Well, that's a start. That's like saying, yeah, I have a wheelchair ramp to our building. But that's certainly not the only thing you want to do, because that's not the only disability that's relevant. And that's not the only way to help people that have that disability. So, blindness is one example. Now, when we talked about a wheelchair being not people confined to a wheelchair permanently are not the only people that are affected by things such as, you know, stairs and so on. We said there's sort of milder forms of the condition or temporary forms of the condition. What are milder forms of blindness? What are other vision-related problems that someone could have that could affect their ability to navigate the web?
Like color blindness.
Color blindness, absolutely. Color blindness person isn't blind. They're just not able to distinguish colors. And again, even that's a simplification, right? Because there's a whole bunch of forms of color blindness. Some you can't tell the difference between red and green. It just sort of looks like a grayish or brownish blob, all right? And so on. What'll be another form of vision related issue? Yes?
People that can't read small text.
Yeah, people that just have bad eyesight. All right. Now here's something that we're going to come to that's unfortunate. All right. But as we list these disabilities and we start talking about milder forms of these, all right, we're going to find that older people have a lot of sort of the milder forms of these disabilities. In other words, older people aren't blind necessarily, but typically older people don't have particularly good eyesight, so they have a hard time reading smaller text. All right. When we talk about some of the other disabilities, we'll find that too. Older people aren't necessarily deaf, but they can't hear as well as younger people as a rule, and so on. All right? I'm doing this for a couple reasons. First of all, again, there is a misperception even among people that should know better that say, well, we're just, you know, accessibility relates to building websites for the blind. That's only a part of the issue. That's only a subset of the issue. And therefore, they justify not spending a lot of effort in making their site accessible because they think it's only affecting a small percentage of the population. Well, first of all, I would say, regardless of the percentage of the population, it's the right thing to do to make your site accessible. All right? However, when you consider that for every disability you have people that maybe don't have the full disability, but have some issues in that area, then it becomes a much greater number of people that are affected here. All right? And there is a potential to get sued if your website is not accessible. I'm not a lawyer, all right, but the American Disabilities Act, you know, depending on the kind of company it is and so on, if your site poses obstacles to people that are disabled, you could be potentially sued. All right. Okay, what are other disabilities besides vision related? Yes.
I don't know if it'd be vision, but epilepsy.
Epilepsy. And I'm going to include in that other sort of neurological conditions. How is that relevant? Exactly. You can't have flashing colors, all right, or flashing animations, all right, because they potentially trigger seizures, all right, not all the time and not to every person, but they can trigger seizures. What else could be a problem? What other sort of people might have a problem with animations or screens that flash or things like that? Besides people that it might trigger seizures on. Yes?
Feel like
people that have some form of ADHD that are easily distracted have the potential to do that. So again, that is a big issue for that. Any other disability? Besides epilepsy, neurological issues. Yes?
I guess to accept if you're deaf.
If you're deaf. Deaf obviously has the issue of not being able to hear audio. And again, there's people that are totally deaf. There's people that simply don't hear as well as they used to. All right. I know for a fact there's one person in this room that that's true for. All right. What's another way that someone's hearing could be compromised? That it would be difficult to hear something? Another situation. Maybe not having anything to do with the person, but having something to do with the situation they're in. In the environment, yeah. For example, in our labs, we don't have speakers in our lab. All right, because if we had speakers in our lab, we would have, you know, 15 songs playing all the time, and I'd be telling everyone to turn it down, and everyone would turn it down for a minute. Then when I went out to get a drink, it'd be turned back up again, and it'd be really hard if you were trying to listen to something. All right, you wouldn't really be able to distinguish it. Or in a library, you know, library, you want to be quiet. Now, you could have headphones, but if you didn't happen to have headphones with you, and the only way that the content was available was through an audio, you'd sort of be out of luck. All right? It bugs me, for example, that a lot of news stories, they'll only have a video for it. They won't have a text for it. All right? Because I can read real fast, and I can look and scan through text to see if it's a news story I'm interested in or not. And if I'm interested in, then I can maybe take the time to watch the video. And if I'm not interested in it, then I just move on. Sort of a side question. Why do you think they do that, have things that are video only as opposed to having a text version of it?
They want you to watch their ads.
They want you to watch their ads. Absolutely. All right? It's easy to ignore ads. When they're built into the page, if you have to sit through a 30-second ad to see the cat that chases a laser pointer, you might be more willing to do that. All right, I know I would be. All right. This comes to, and we're going to continue with this because we're not done, but I want to bring up at this point the notion of universal design, because I alluded to that. And universal design means designing for everyone. It doesn't mean designing simply for people with disabilities or simply with people without disabilities. And there's two key principles of universal design. And I hope we can see these as we go through. Because after we finish these, we're going to talk a little bit about the assistive technologies, and then we're going to talk about the accommodations, in other words, what we can do on our web page to help people with these disabilities. Universal design has sort of two principles, maybe three. One of them is simplicity. Keep it simple. All right? So, for example, if you had some animation where the screen was flashing, you as a designer should ask yourself something. Do I really need that? Does it add to the page? All right. Is it something that is an important part of the content of the page? Or is it something that I just put on the page because I thought it looked cool? If the answer is, which it is in many, many, many cases, it's something I'm putting there because I thought it looked cool, then don't. Don't put it there. Simplify. All right? Because you won't have to worry then about triggering seizures in people or distracting someone with ADHD or anything like that. And you know what? People that don't have those conditions don't want those silly flashing things on their page either, unless they happen to add to the content of the page. All right? So, simple. All right? Ask yourself, is this content needed? Any content will take away from anything else on the page, right? So if I have one image on the page,
people are going to be drawn to that image. If I have two images on the page, well, people will spend part of their time looking at one, part of their time looking at another. If I have 15 images on the page, it's going to be some images that are going to get lost in the shuffle. All right? So it might be better, instead of putting 15 images on the page, to put the best two images on there, the two that you think most accurately convey your content. A lot of this is, again, it's a universal design. This isn't designing for people with disabilities. This is designing for everyone. So as a rule, when we looked at those bad websites, think of the guy that had the car dealership in the UK. Was his page too simple or too complex? It was too complex. Too much going on. All right? And many bad web pages and websites are like that. All right? It is possible to develop pages that are too simple. They have not enough stuff on them. All right? But that's not the problem that most organizations have. Most organizations that develop bad websites, they're bad because they have overkill. They do too much in it. Now, the second principle is multiple presentation of the same content. Because can anyone think of an example of having multiple ways to present the same content? Let's say I have a video of an interview between two people, a journalist and someone that just released a new movie, all right? The video will be one way to present that interview. It will be another way to present that same interview, yes?
Like a transcript of it.
A transcript of it, right. Will be another way still that we could do it. Well, with closed captions, right? So the video could be captioned. So there's two ways of presenting the same material. We can hear the material or we can read it. All right? Why is that good? Well, it's obviously good for people with disabilities, right? Because if you only had the video with the accompanying audio, then someone that's deaf couldn't access that content. On the flip side, if you only had the text, people have a hard time reading or whatever, people might prefer to have it narrated to them. All right? So if you can present the content a couple different ways, then that's a good thing. And almost any content that you can think of, you can come up with ways to present it a couple different ways. You can have pictures along with text, right? So, if you wanted to talk about the red carpet at the Academy Awards, you could have a long description about who wore what and what designer they wore and all that kind of things. Or you could have a couple of pictures, all right? And in both cases, you're conveying the same information, all right? So presenting the same content a couple different ways. Now, you might say that these two things go against each other, contradict each other. In one case, I'm saying, make it simple, make it simple, make it simple. In another sense, I'm saying, well, say the same thing two different ways. That's sort of the opposite of simple, right? Simple would be just saying things one way. Well, that's where, as a designer, you figure out a way to balance it. So, for example, you know, you wouldn't throw everything but the kitchen sink at content. So I wouldn't necessarily have text, an audio file, a video file, an animation. If I was showing the results of a Cleveland Browns game, I wouldn't have text, pictures, video, an animation, and all these, and an audio file. I'd just pick a couple of the ways that I thought worked best for the story that I wanted to tell. All right, the content that I wanted to convey. So yes, in one respect, these two things conflict a little bit, But that's where you, as a designer, have to balance things out. That's your job, is to figure out the best way to tell a story, the best way to communicate to your target audience, to the people that you want to, the information that you're trying to convey. Now, the third element we don't really talk about in this class, and in a way it's just is another part of multiple presentations, and that is to have the ability to customize. I guess that could be part of simplifying too. Sometimes when you go to a news site, you can pick like what sort of news stories you're interested in. Am I interested in, travel stories, sports, weather? If I'm interested in weather, what city am I interested in the weather in? Am I interested in national news, international news, finance news, business news, that kind of thing? And you can then check what you're interested in, and then you get a page that's made just for you. And that's really cool, because that simplifies things. Instead of seeing 100 news stories, you might see the 25 that relate to you, that you've said is what you're interested in. That also can help with multiple presentation, because I can view the page one way with one color scheme. I can view the page another way if I'm colorblind and this other color scheme works for me. All right? So I can choose to present the same output. I can customize the way my page looks to make it easier for me to read. Bigger font versus smaller font, and so on. Different color schemes. So as we go through and talk about these things, we want to keep these notions in mind. All right, what are some other disabilities? I sort of alluded to one, and I'll call them cognitive disabilities. These are things like ADHD and also dyslexia. ADHD is attention deficit hyperactive disorder, something like that. And what is dyslexia? You mix up letters is a good way to put it. A lot of people think dyslexia is that you flip words around. That's not the case. It's not like you see a word spelled backwards or something like that. It's that certain letters that are similar shaped are confusing to you, and your mind doesn't see them. Your mind doesn't interpret them. Your mind has difficulty interpreting them. All right? So if I had a word like bad, the B and D have a very similar shape. There's a possibility that someone could confuse one or both of those letters. And from what I understand, I'm not dyslexic, but from what I understand, it's not like this happens all the time. It's not like someone, every time they read a B, they flip it to a D or something like that. All right, it's just depending on particular circumstances. Is anyone dyslexic or knows anyone that's dyslexic? If you don't want to answer, that's okay. Yes?
I know somebody who is.
Okay. And what is their experience? Do they talk to you about it?
From what I talked to her about it, she has to read a lot slower because if she reads too fast, everything starts moving on the page, like the letters
okay.
start moving.
All right. Interesting. All right. Any other issues that we can think of? Yes?
Impaired motor skills.
Yeah, impaired motor skills. And that motor skills is the ability to move. So, someone in a wheelchair, if the issue was only with their legs, that wouldn't necessarily cause a problem. But they also had issues moving their arms. That could cause a problem because moving the mouse, typing on a keyboard, that sort of thing can be difficult. So there's that kind of thing. Someone that would have, for example, cerebral palsy, or someone that had other forms of sort of conditions that compromise their ability to move. Carpal tunnel would be an example. Arthritis would be an example. Again, these are not as severe as someone that literally can't move their arms. All right, someone like Stephen Hawking, for example, would be a very dramatic case. All right, that actually uses pointers other ways. You know, compared to someone that just happened to have arthritis and has a hard time pointing to a real specific part of the screen. All right. Finally, as I mentioned before, old age. It's not really a disability, but it's something that can compromise a person's ability because, in a way, old age has a little bit of all of these things. A person's memory isn't as good as when they get older. Did I click on that link already? All right. Well, we can, if our page is designed, we let them know that they've clicked on that link, which is valuable for them and valuable for everyone else. Compromising with motor skills. Doctor told me anyone over the age of, I forget what, has some form of arthritis in them, right? So as you get older, that can potentially cause issues navigating a page. As I said before, not deaf, but definitely hard of hearing. This one I'm not really sure, neurological conditions. I don't know if older people would tend to be more sensitive to like the flashing sort of things that trigger seizures than younger people, all right? But it would be distracting for them just as it would for anyone. And again, poor eyesight. Okay, so in terms of assistive technologies, all right, for blind, there are screen readers. I'll tell you what. What time is it? I'm going to do something I never do. I'm going to end 2 minutes early. All right? Because I don't want to start this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take a picture of this. We'll talk more and we'll fill out these. Actually, I won't take a picture of it. I'll remember it. Or someone will remember it. All right, for next time. And we will start back next time talking about the assistive technologies that exist, but probably more importantly, what we can do as designers to design our pages in a way that make them more accessible. All right, I'll go unlock the lab, I'll come back here to get my files, and then I'll be back.